when I looked at the problems that I saw with students who study at universities, even outside universities, emails that people sent me, and communication that I have with youngsters, youth, I try to bottle down the problem. Where does it really stem from? Because you can always give a cure, and that cure tends to be a temporary solution. So what I hope, inshallah ta'ala, is to get a long-term solution for everything. That if you all take this on board, wallahi brothers, it will change everything in your life. It really will. And it is the answer to problems, not on an individual level only. But I'm talking about countries, I'm talking about governments, I'm talking about everything. This is the solution for the people. Wallahi it is. And that is the correct understanding of what Tawheed is. And it might sound to you all, or some of you, really? You really think that's the answer to everything? I say that without a shadow of a doubt it is. So let's try to understand what it really is. Brothers and sisters, you are today in this world. Allah brought you here today. Wallahi, if you think, why am I here for? What's the reason I'm in this world for? I'm breathing oxygen, I'm eating, I'm drinking. So those of you who are married, I've got a wife, I've got kids, I'm driving, I'm coming back from work. Why has Allah put me in this environment? Why? Allah clearly tells you there's really one goal and one reason why He's done that. And everything else needs to serve that. And that is, I brought you to this world so you can worship me. You can be my slave. That you worship me and you submit to me and you adhere me. Brothers and sisters, please pay attention here. I can give you so much ayat, I can give you so much ahadith, but the truth of the matter is that simple for us to ponder. Billahi alaykum, think here right now, think with me. You are in this world and Allah doesn't want anything else from you right now except what? That you worship Him. He says it clearly in the Quran. He says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create jinn, nor did I create the ins, except to worship Him. By Allah, do you live for that purpose? If I drink right now, if I eat right now, everything should work towards ibadah. I drink so I can strengthen myself, so I can gain energy for my food, for my drinking, so I can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the way we live our lives is, ibadah revolves around our pleasure and our needs. And so we haven't taken Allah as our Lord, our Supreme Lord that deserves to be worshipped. And Allah says in the Quran, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَى. Do you not see the one who has taken his desires as his Lord? He actually worships his own desires. That's his Lord. That's his ilah. Ilah means what? A master. A one you worship. One that tells you stand up, you say okay. Tells you to sit down, you say okay. He tells you to do something, you say okay, and you submit. Billahi alaykum, is that how we live our lives today, or are we opposite to that? Many of us, including me, we pick what we want to take from the religion. We don't fully want to submit as slaves. Ibn al-Qayyim says, "Harabu min al-riq alladhi khuliqu lahu, fabulu biriq al-nafs wal-shaytani." They ran away for being slaves to Allah. They ran away from that. And they became slaves to their own whims and desires. And that's why you find many people who've refused to be slaves to Allah. And they don't want to worship Him. They've become slaves to their nafs and their desires themselves. And they ended up not wanting to live anymore. And they email you and they say, I'm very suicidal. I slit my arm. I just can't live anymore. You know why you can't live? It's simple like this. You as a person need a percentage of water every day. Sahih? True or false, brothers? Brothers, isn't that the case? So if you don't have enough water in your system, what happens to you? You dehydrate. And in long term, it causes you a serious illness, and then maybe you might die from it. True or false? Your car needs oil. If you don't place that oil in the car, it might go today or tomorrow, but in the long term, it's going to break down on you, right? Your brain, your body, your mind needs to be a slave to Allah. It needs it. It craves for that. If it doesn't, it becomes suicidal. And that's the reality Ibn al-Qayyim drew. حَرَبُوا مِنَ الرِّقِ الَّذِي خُلِقُوا لَهُ فَبُلُوا بِرِقِ النَّفْسِ وَالشَّيْطَانِ. And that's what I say, and I always say this to the brothers I teach and sisters. I say to them that the joy a person receives from being a slave is far greater than anything that the person can be given. Sah? You agree to that, brothers? Sah?
Yes.
Even if it entails that you suffer physically, you physically suffer, you go through a lot of hardship, what is it that you will always crave for? What is it? I was Somali and I saw a guy who sells 7 sweets every morning. He wakes up, he only sells 7 sweets. Some of you probably heard this story from me. He doesn't have no money, nothing. He only has 7 sweets that he makes at home, and he takes it out and he sells it. When he sells it, he comes home, he gives whatever money he's made to his wife and the kids, and he just takes a very small percentage from it, and he buys a cup of tea with it. He sits in the restaurant, he's drinking tea with his friends. Salah, he's at the front row. And wallahi, when I saw him, the way he smiles and the way he's happy, it's amazing. He smiles, he really is happy. But he doesn't have nothing. He's going to make the same sweets tomorrow to sell it. My question to you is, you probably have more money in your account. You've probably got, what do you call it, more financial stability than he does. Why is it you're suffering more? Whenever the envelope opens and the door, you're like, oh, what letter is going to come? Is it made? You're worried. You're living a life of hardship. It's because the more you distance yourself from being that slave to your master, is the way Allah has then forsaken you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why I think, and I believe, was the wisdom why our Prophet ﷺ chose when he came to Mecca. And you have to realize that the reality of Mecca. How was Mecca like, brothers and sisters? It was, crime rate was high. Drugs and alcohol was what was used. Alcohol at that time. What do you call it? Killing and murdering was high. Idol worshipping. The Prophet did not start talking about any other problem that the community had. Which one did he start with? Huh? Were the companions at the beginning stage of Islam, were they drinking alcohol while they were praying? They were. And he didn't address that, alayhi salatu wasalam. He did not address that. Some men were married to 100 women. He didn't address all of that. All of that was a problem he left for one thing first. First of all is that, are these people in acknowledgement? Do they agree that they are slaves? Sahih? Do they admit that they are? There's a master who they have to submit to, they have to follow his commands, and they have to do as he tells them to do? Let's first of all install that into their heads. And if you look at what's happening in universities today, and wallahi, if you look at what's happening in studying places, you will realize that the problem today with all of these isms that you're hearing, whether it be any group, just mention it, you will find they're fighting with the concept of what? Rubudiyya, servitude. They're fighting with the concept of what? Being slaves. So brothers and sisters, I'm here to say to you all, the solution is not far. It is, as a youngster in university studying, what is needed from you is that you become a slave. Surrender. Admit that you have nothing in your hands. Say to Allah, Nasiyati biyadik, my affairs is in your hands, and you control me. Do that at the time when you're going through ease and good, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be there to help you at the times of hardship. This message I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters, is a message that was sent to every prophet that came. You guys all know Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, right? How long was Nuh with his people for? Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فَلَبِثَ فِيهِمْ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ إِلَّا 50 عَامًا. Nuh came to his people for how many years? 950 years. I asked you kindly and generously, can any one of you here tell me what Nuh's da'wah was? What was he calling to? 950 years, you can imagine. Is that 2 years or 3 years? Brothers and sisters, 950 years. You can now not say to me that you know anything about Nuh's da'wah except Tawheed. Are you telling me that's what he called these people to? But that's the only thing that is highlighted on, right? It shows you that his underlying principle was Tawheed, monotheism. Sah? Allah says in another place, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ. Allah says in another ayah, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ Muhammad, we have not said before you, مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَّا عَبُدُونَ Muhammad, before you, salawatullahi wa salam alayhi, we have not sent a messenger. Now pay attention. From Nabiullah Nuh to Nabiullah Muhammad, there's one thing they all had in common. Common. There was no difference. Their prayer was different. Their fasting was different. Their ibadat was different. But one thing they were not different. Not one prophet came and said, Trinity is true. All the prophets, min laddun Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, from Nabiullah Nuh, until our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every prophet was saying, Ya qawm i'budullaha, ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. My people, worship Allah. You have no Lord besides Allah which you should worship. There isn't. Allah says another ayah, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ فَجِتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ Every prophet's message was, worship Allah and stay away from everything that is worship besides Allah. Sah, brothers and sisters. Is there everybody amongst you right now, every day that you wake up, you go through hardship, right? Not necessarily every day, but you go through hardship in your life, true or false. Is there anyone who doesn't go through any hardship? Huh? You all go through hardship, right? One way or another. But Allah tells us in the Quran, He says, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ Allah created death and He created life. Why? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ To test you. Test you with what? أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا Which of you have the best of actions? Not the one who has the most actions. The one who has that? Fudayl ibn Iyad commented on this verse. And guess what he said? The best of action means here what? What does it mean, the best of action? Huh? أَخْلَصُهُ وَأَصْوَبُهُ The best of action means here the one who has action that is in accordance to the Sunnah and it's done only for Allah. It's done with Tawheed. Let's go back again on that verse again. Allah is saying, تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموتى Allah is the one who created death. والحياة Allah is the one who created life. Why? ليبلوكم أي The reason why He created life and death is to test you, to put you to the test. Because remember, gold, it shines in the fire. When the gold starts to become a bit rusty, it doesn't fully become rusty, but if you put it in the fire and you burn it, the gold shines even more. The believer's like that. The more trials and tribulation he goes through, the more he shines. So, he shines. He doesn't fall. So guess what? Allah is saying, now that I'm testing you with what? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا Which of you has the best of actions? And the best of action here means that which is according to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and that which is done with sincerity. And that's why a person makes it through every trial and tribulation that's brought their way, they come out of it not feeling any effect on them. Of course, everybody suffers. Everybody feels pain. But that test does not move your religion. Are you with me? Brothers and sisters, if your enemy testifies and says to you, you know what? You, I can't get you because of this. What do you admit? What would you think? Wow, mashallah. You think, my enemy knows he can't catch me. Our enemy, Iblis, admitted that he cannot misguide a group of people. Look what he said. He said, لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ Oh Allah, I'm going to misguide everyone. إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ The only slaves I will not be able to misguide, that I won't deviate from the straight path, are those who have ikhlas is tawheed. Sincerity. These people do it only for Allah. They live their life only for Allah. Okay, now you see, I'm trying to show you, sisters and brothers, that every problem that you ask, it all goes back to him. There's a deficiency to him. A brother goes and commits zina, and I say to him, there's a deficiency in your tawheed. People are going to be like, are you serious? Sah. Look what Allah said about Yusuf alayhi salam. Yusuf, when the woman came up to him, why did Allah save him from it? Innahu min ibadina al-mukhlaseen. He was from our slaves who had sincerity. He had tawheed. His tawheed was strong. Sahih, brothers? Again, it goes back to that. This is why I'm saying this is the underlying reason why you see people are not. This is the best advice I can give you. Study your Tawheed. Live by it. Learn what it means. What does Tawheed entail? What does it mean? I ask you a question. You're driving today, you've got a car, and you come to a, you know, those yellow candles, okay? And it says you have to drive on the lane, you have to drive 40 miles per hour, okay? Are we all together, brothers and sisters? 40 miles per hour you have to drive. You know if you don't drive on 40 miles per hour, what's going to happen? Huh? Huh? You get flagged, what's going to happen after that? You're going to get a ticket, blah, blah, blah. Maybe even your parts of your license, right? So you know the severity of the consequences that you're going to endure, right? You know the severity of the consequences that you're going to endure. Let's just say hypothetically, somebody just came yesterday from Somalia, okay? Don't get upset, brothers from Somalia. Somebody just comes from Somalia yesterday. They land, they get given a car, the keys are passed over to them. Let's say they can't drive. And they're told to drive. When they come to that light, that box, that red box, will it mean anything to them? Will they go through it? Huh? Will they fear any consequences from it? Why? Because they don't know. Okay? This is the reality of people who commit crimes in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's how they are. They don't know. They're ignorant. They don't know their master, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why they've made him ahwal nadhirina ilayh, the weakest and the lowest of those who look at. You wouldn't dare to do some of the things that you do, some of the things that you say. You won't do that in public. You won't do that in front of a respected person in your community. You won't. But when it comes to Allah, you would. Okay? I always mention this story. There was a muhaqqiq in Riyadh. I met him. He's a muhaqqiq. He's an author. He puts works together. And I met him. And I didn't know it was him. So I was talking to him and I was kind of informing him things. You know, I was kind of instructing him. This guy is a big man of knowledge. I'm telling him things like, yeah, this is what you have to do. No, later I find out it was him. I found out who it was. I was like, no. Why did I act in that way in the beginning towards him? What was the reason? Because I didn't know who he was. The minute I found out it was him, this is Sheikh Fulan, really? And it was humble, he was just listening to me, he was like, Jazakallah khairan. My point is, the minute I found out it was him, what happened to me? I felt, my heart dropped. I felt confused. What was I doing? What was I saying, huh? This is the reality. When a person learns Allah, they just can't do some things. They hold back. I can't let Allah see me do this. Because the value of Allah is great in their eyes. Again, this point of ibadah. This concept of aqeedah and tawheed being strengthened in the people's eyes. And you making sure that you have it. Brothers and sisters, if you went today and you prayed a salah without tahara, whether that tahara is major or minor impurity, would that salah be accepted? Huh? Would it be accepted? It won't be accepted, right? Because the Prophet said, لَا يَقْبَلُ اللَّهُ صَلَاةَ أَحَدِكُمْ إِذَا حَدَّثَ حَتَّى يَتَوَضَّأَ. The same way is if a person does a righteous deed of obedience and they don't do it with tawheed, it won't be accepted. It's the same. It's no different. That's why every single day you're there to do everything for Allah alone. Some of you sisters right now, you're in a classroom, another sister may ask you for a pen. Look how shaytan will make you miss out on this reward. Brother asks you for a pen, he says, can I use your pen? You say, yeah. If only you came with an intention, you would have got a reward. You would have got for what you've just done, for what you've just did, what you've just done, what do you get for it? I'm asking a question. Where's the reward from? Huh? Because of your intention. It's not to give the pen. If you gave the pen with no intention, it won't be accepted. But it's the intention you're getting rewarded for. So this is how powerful it is that a person realizes the reality of every righteous deed is a reflection of what's in your heart. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said to us in the hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. That every action is based upon what a person intends. Allah said to the Prophet, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Allah says to the Prophet والسلام, Muhammad, if you associate partners with Allah, if you do shirk, Allah will nullify all your righteous deeds. And guess what you're going to be from? You're going to be from those who are destroyed, and you're going to be from those who are upon a state of loss. Muhammad, you, forget anybody else. And the Arabs, they say this meaning, when Allah is talking to the Prophet, the Arabs, they have a saying called, إِيَّاكَ أَعْنِي وَاسْمَعْ يَا جَارَ, which is a method, an example that the Arabs use, is that when you're really talking, you're talking to this person, but you actually really mean these people. Because our Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, would he have fallen into shirk? No. He would not have fallen into shirk. But the issue is you guys, us, it destroys your righteous deeds. So now I'm going to conclude with a point which I think is very important, which is, what's ibadah? What does ibadah actually mean? What's the meaning in which it holds? We divide ibadah into two. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? The first is the action of ibadah that we do, the action itself. Okay? The way that we do the ibadah, the way that we do it. Are we all together? A person, when it comes to doing ibadah, when it comes to doing ibadah, as in how should I do the ibadah, it has to be done with two things. What are the two things that it has to be done with? Yeah? Complete love with complete humility. Sah? You humble yourself. You can, like for example, somebody might tell you, bully you, okay? And say you put your head down on the floor, prostrate you. Do it. And they put you in a and you're very weak. So you might do it, okay? You might do that. They belittle you, humiliate you, and you do it. Method, I'm just saying. Now my question is, when you're doing that, are you in a state of humiliation? Yes. But are you in a state of love? No one does it combine both for except Allah. Like your humbleness and your love for Him, like you're taking your most honorable part of your body, your face, and you're placing it on the dust of the earth, and you're, this is a state of love. Humbleness with love. Sahih? Are we together, brother? Those two, they are parallel with Allah. That's how we do our ibadah. So now that's how you do it. But the question is, what verifies, what can we actually say is a ibadah itself? It's anything that is speech, action, or even heart-related matters. So it's qawl, which is speech, amal, which is action, and qalb, which is the heart. Ibadah occurs from those three places. But how, okay, this is all the places you do it from, okay, good. But how do I know this is an ibadah if Allah loves it and He's pleased with it? So let's give an example of the action of the heart. Action of the heart, for example, is وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ. أَنِيبُوا, turn to your Lord. Action of the heart. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى الَّذِي إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهُ إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاء. Those who have خَشْيَة. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ يَخْشَوْنَ. We have fear. Fear, خَشْيَة is what? It's an action of the heart. What about speech? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا. Dhikr on the tongue is an action of the heart, an action of the tongue. This is something Allah loves and He's pleased with. Huh? What about actions of your limbs? وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. Are we all together, brothers? All of these are ibadat. You're not allowed to divert it for anybody other than Allah. It should only be for Him alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala.